So this last spring, when the temperatures were much milder and we were actually getting, I felt like, an appreciable amount of rain, I was really hopeful that this summer was going to be different. Maybe you had those hopes as well. But here we are. Things changed very quickly. We're mid-July, right? Probably been at least, I don't know, I was thinking a month this morning, but it's probably been more like 6 weeks or more that we've had any appreciable amount of rain. The temperatures are hovering around 100 degrees. You look at the forecast, and it's 100 degrees or more for the next 10 days. And very little rain in the forecast. There is a little bit of rain, but frankly, I was telling my wife and my neighbor this last night, I kind of feel like that's just wishful thinking by the meteorologists. Seems like it never actually happens. So here we are. In fact, it's called the NIDIS. I think that's what we call it, the National Integrated Drought Information System. Look it up on the internet. They say that Central Texas, Williamson County, Travis County, that we are now in a moderate to severe drought, and that these conditions will last for foreseeable. Way to brighten up your day this morning, right? You knew that. I didn't have to tell you that. You know it. You live in this area. You came in this morning. I can't tell you how many, it's funny, kind of uncanny how this happened, how many people were talking about how hot it was, how dry it was, how a sprinkler wasn't working in their yard. It's like, man, does this roll right into my sermon today? We're in a drought, and it stinks. It can take away our joy. Makes us yearn, right? Yearn for water. We need it. Animals, plants, human beings. Things are ugly and dry. It's not. There's another drought. The drought that's been going on since Adam and Eve in the garden. And it's persisted throughout history all the way up to today. And it's a lot more widespread, and it's a lot more dangerous than the drought that we are experiencing in Texas. It affects us, right? Just like physical drought does, but even more so. It saps our energy. It makes us yearn for something to feed our soul, to feed ourselves. We feel angry and lost, and we look for something that can fix that. There's a drought going on, and it affects every single one of us. There's not a person in this room that the drought doesn't affect. It's not caused by a lack of water, though. It's caused by a lack of God. All of us are sinners. All of us have a sinner that lives inside of us. The sinner inside of us wants nothing to do with God, and it loves the drought. So all of us are affected by the drought. In fact, you feel symptoms of it. You know you're experiencing this drought when you feel lonely, when you feel sad, when you feel angry, when you feel unfulfilled, when you are questioning your value or your worth. All of that is due to the drought that every single one of us experiences inside of us. And if the conditions don't improve with this drought, things don't get better, the effects can be devastating, not just in this life, but eternally. Thankfully, our God is very aware of the drought that's going on. He's known about it since before time began. He knew that it would come, and he knew that it would affect every single one of us. But not only is he aware of it, but he has the cure. And the cure is the gospel. The person and the work of Jesus Christ, what this book is centered around. The gospel of Jesus Christ, the Savior. A Savior who would come to bring forgiveness and redemption and salvation. That is the cure for the drought. God first announced his cure in the garden, shortly after Adam and Eve fell into sin. And ever since then, throughout time, he has proclaimed and described that gospel through various people at various times and places. He's had it written down in this book for us. Isaiah is one of the books, little books, within the bigger book called the Bible. And Isaiah has many, many descriptions and pictures about the cure, about the coming Savior. Some of them amazing, wonderful, very colorful pictures about the gospel. Isaiah 40 through 66, which is the last 27 chapters of the book of Isaiah, in the original language, it's like one big poem describing and proclaiming the cure, God's cure, gospel. And chapter 53 is the middle of that poem, and it's like a mountain peak. Many of you, if I even sang Isaiah 53, probably already words come to mind to you. It's a beautiful, incredible chapter of the Bible with many details, amazing details, prophecy about the cure, about the Savior, Jesus Christ, saying things like this, as he would be stricken and afflicted by God, that he would take up our pain, that he would bear our suffering, that he would be pierced for our sins, that he would be crushed for our iniquities, that the punishment that he endured bring us peace. It's a beautiful, incredible chapter describing, claiming pure gospel of Jesus Christ. Isaiah 55, which is our text for today, is God again describing, proclaiming the cure, but he's also saying, come, everyone, come. Come and partake of the cure. It's here. I know you're thirsting. I know you're hungering. I know you're going through a drought. Here's the cure. So come and get it. Like I said, it's our text for today. It's printed out for you in the bulletin. It'll also be up on the screens. Follow along as I read to you the first few verses of chapter 55. Listen, that you may live. I will make an everlasting covenant with you, my faithful love promised to David. See, I have made a witness to the peoples, a ruler and commander of the peoples. Surely you will summon nations you know not, and nations you do not know will come running to you because of the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, for he has endowed you with splendor. God's word so far. Here in those last verses, God is speaking about the cure. He's speaking about the Savior to come when he calls him the Holy One of Israel, my faithful love promised to David. I've made him a witness to the people. That's all about the cure. But did you notice in those early verses how many times God says, come? It's at least five times God says, come. Why? Like I said earlier, because he knows. He knows that every single one of you are dealing with the drought. That every single one of you have a hunger in your soul, have a thirst in your soul that needs to be satisfied. It needs to be quenched. He knows that you are lonely and sad and you have all these feelings and emotions, and he says, I have the cure. It's the gospel. So come, come and quench your thirst. Come and satisfy your hunger. The picture is really like a merchant in a marketplace. So if you can imagine a merchant, right, in the big marketplace, and he's standing by his booth or by his table of goods, and he's saying, come, come, come and partake. Come and partake of the goods that I have. It's literally God pleading with us, begging us. He says, I know what's going on in your lives. I know the drought's going on, so come, come. It's right here. Here's the cure for you. But there's also something that's very different about God's call to us and a merchant in the marketplace. Catch it? This is free. Even though he says, come and buy, but he says, without money, without cost, you who have no money, it's free. The gospel is free. Jesus paid the price for it. It's all yours. So God says, come, come and partake of it. But there's a problem. You and I often don't respond to the call. Maybe we don't hear it. Maybe we don't really realize or feel like there's a problem in our lives. We don't even realize there's a drought going on, which is kind of crazy. That would be like any of us walking around outside in the heat of the day, in the dead of summer, and someone saying, you know there's a drought going on? Really? Wow, that's surprising. I mean, how crazy that is? Well, that's as crazy as us not realizing that there's a drought. There is a drought going on inside of us. The other thing that we do, maybe we realize, this is probably more like, you know it's going on. You feel it. Like I said earlier, when you feel lost, when you feel angry, when you feel lonely, when you feel sad, when you feel like you don't have a purpose, when you feel like you don't have value, when you don't have worth, that's drought. And you felt, I know you have, each of you. But instead of going to the gospel, we look to other things. Sometimes people will turn to not so good things for the fix. They're feeling the symptoms of the drought. They may turn to drugs, or alcohol, morality, crime. But you and I can also turn to things that are not so healthy, maybe a little more subtle. We complain. We criticize. Blame others for what we're eating. We binge on Netflix. We fill our lives with stuff that's not so healthy, thinking that's going to help me deal with this. Sometimes we turn to good things, but they're not the thing. They're not the cure. So sometimes we think, you know, if I just work hard enough and get the best education I can get the best job I can, that is going to take care of all of this that I'm feeling. That's going to be the cure for the drought. If I can just, you know, make my family just the way it's supposed to be, and we can, all our relationships can be great, perfect, everything's going well, and I can make sure my kids are on the right path. Good things, but not the thing. Not the cure. If I can just achieve this, whatever it might be, sports, career, leisure stuff, if I can have the best house, whatever, we look to those things and we pour time and energy and cost into those things, and like God says, they don't satisfy. They're good things, but they're not the thing. They're not the cure. Somehow, We have to learn when we're dealing with the drought inside of us, we need to learn how to tap into the cure. We need to learn how to turn on the faucet, God's spiritual faucet. So how do we do that? Let's look at our next verse, okay? Look at verses 6 through 8. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call on him while he is near. I actually meant to read those part of the last section. Let the wicked forsake their ways, and the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them turn to the Lord. He will have mercy on them. To our God, he will freely pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. So the first thing God wants us to do to tap into the cure, turn on the spiritual faucet, is to turn. It's another word for repent in the Bible. And I like Pastor Joel's image of this. It literally means to turn from this path to this path. Turn. To turn from man's ways and man's thoughts that are wicked and sinful and unrighteous and don't work, to God's thoughts and ways that work and that are the cure. That's what God wants us to do. He wants us to quit trying to find our value and our identity and our worth and satisfy the hunger that's inside of us with God's thoughts and ways. Quit doing that. They don't work. God says, turn to my ways, because my ways are not your ways. My thoughts and ways are higher than the heavens are above the earth. They're the way. They're the right way. So turn to that way. God says he wants you to turn. Repent for your following those not good ways. And when you do that, something amazing happens. God does something really amazing and probably unexpected. He forgives you. Said that. The verse, right? It says, let them turn from their ways, and he will have mercy on them. He will freely pardon. See, one way that our ways are not like God's ways is we say things like this. You know what? Gosh, I screwed up so much. And maybe you're sitting here in the pews going, man, have I been following the wrong ways, trying to fix the drought that's inside of me. I have messed up so much, God. Surely you're going to punish me for that. And God says, no. My ways are not your ways. I'm not slow to forgive. I will not treat you as your sins deserve. That's what mercy means. He says, I will have forgiveness for you. God showers us with his forgiveness. He pours the water of his grace out on us when we turn. He forgives us. Beautiful. It's wonderful. That's one of the ways that we tap into the cure. It's one of the ways that God shows us the cure, the ways that God showers us with his grace. Turn. There's another way we can tap into the cure, turn on the spiritual faucet in verses 10 through 13. God says, as the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return to it without watering the earth and making it bud and flourish, so that it yields seed for the sower and bread for the eater, so is my word that goes out from my mouth. It will not return to me empty, but will accomplish what I desire and achieve the purpose for which I sent it. You will go out in joy and be led forth in peace. The mountains and hills will burst into song before you, and all the trees of the field will clap their hands. Instead of the thorn bush will grow the juniper, and instead of briars the myrtle will grow. This will be for the Lord's renown, for an everlasting sign that will forever. You know, one of the most refreshing and invigorating things that can happen in the dead of summer is when a rain shower shows up, right? And it sometimes in Texas seems to come out of nowhere. A long, steady shower. It's so refreshing. In fact, you've probably done this. We have done this. Our family have done it. It feels so good that you don't even care what you're wearing, what you have on. You go out, just want to feel the rain come down, right? It's so refreshing for you. Well, that's the picture here that God is using. But it's not about water. It's not about rain. He's using that as a picture for what his word does. His word, in the same way as it comes down from heaven, just as the rain and the snow does, and just as certainly as when the water hits the earth, right? And that happens too. When the rain comes down, get a nice shower, it can be dry and brown and ugly, and all of a sudden, it doesn't get perfect, but I mean, it gets greener, right? Things start to sprout up a little bit. The animals seem to be more active. You see squirrels running around a little bit more. And we as humans, we're refreshed. It's like life is reborn. Well, that's the idea here, the picture here. God's saying in the same way, his word came down from heaven through the Bible, and it comes to us, and it's refreshing, and it's invigorating. It creates life, and it's like rebirth happens. And the picture there is really quite stunning and unexpected and amazing, right? Things happen that we would not expect, he says at the last part, right? The thorn bush, will, instead of that, the juniper will grow. Instead of briars, the myrtle will grow. Incredible things happen. Transformation, creation, joy. He talks about joy and peace and celebration. That's what happens when God's word gets into the lives of people. And what is his word? This. I look around, and most of you know that. We talk about that a lot here, that this is God's word. But if you're not sure about that, it is. It says it. If you read it, the writers say, Isaiah says many times in his book that the words are not his words. They're God's words. The Apostle Paul says, we speak in words not from men, but from God. The Apostle Peter says, people are carried along by the Holy Spirit. These are the words of God. That's the word that Isaiah is talking about. But you might say, oh, wait a sec. I'm talking about just words? Ink on a page? They're just markings on a page? This is what God uses? This is what has so much power and for rebirth and transformation? Seriously? Yeah. Yeah. That's what God is saying in these words here. These, the words of the Bible, therefore, are not just talk, not just like when you and I talk. When God speaks through his word, it's power. Things happen. Like he says, it does not return to him empty, but it will accomplish the purpose for which he sent it. Faith is created. Faith is strengthened. You heard Caleb talk about that illustration with his plant, right? That's what works in the hearts and minds of people, is God's word. That's what he uses, and it has incredible power. And we can trust it. So another way, turn on the faucet. Right, tap into the cure for the drought that goes on inside all of us. Get into God's word. I knew you knew that was coming. Get into God's word more. So like Caleb said, come to church. Get into a small group Bible study. Here at Holy Word, we call them connect groups. This fall, we're planning to start some new groups, so you've got some to go to if you don't have one already. Your own personal devotion life. Your family devotion life. Get into God's word more and let it quench your thirst. Let it satisfy the hunger that's inside of you, trusting in its power. I'm sure I could talk to any one of you, and you could share with me a way that the power God's word has worked either in your life or in the lives of people around you. I just want to share one story with you to close today. Many years ago, I was pretty early on in my ministry here at Holy Word. There was a young girl that came to worship here. She was from up north, from our church body. Her name was Kim. And she was in a relationship that didn't work out. She was not doing real well, but she met a very nice young man named Jay. Great guy. He was going to school at ACC. He was going to become a sign language interpreter. It's kind of a unique career. Only one kind of issue. Kim and Jay came to Pastor Patterson and I looking for premarriage counseling. Jay told us, he said, "I'm an atheist. I don't believe that stuff." Grew up in the church, but he had fallen away from it. He said, "I just don't believe it anymore." We talked about that in premarriage counseling, but they loved each other. He was a nice young man, and they got married. I tried to spend time with him and get to know him, just building a friendship. Like Jay, we had some things in common. My wife and I went out to lunch with him and Jay, and we went to his college graduation at ACC. Over time, he told us this in pre-marriage too. He said, "I don't believe it. I'm an atheist." He said, "But I know it's very important to Kim, so I want to support her. She wants to raise our kids in the church, so I am going to come to church sometimes because I kind of want to see what you're teaching, going to be teaching my wife and my kids." So he did. He didn't come every Sunday, but he would come every other Sunday or so, and he'd sit kind of in the back there, kind of back towards where Sheen is sitting. After a while, he said, "I think I want to learn a little more. I love, you know, it's neat coming Sunday." He didn't say I love. He said, "It's neat coming Sunday." He said, "But I want to... Did you have classes or something?" And I said, "We do." And so I started taking them through our adult confirmation classes. I got through three lessons, and they said, "Hey, we're moving. Jay got a job up north." I was like, "No." Felt like we were just getting going. They left. A few months later, I got a text from Jay. We stayed in contact, and he said, "Hey, we got connected with the church here, and I decided I'm going to try to go through the classes with the pastor here." And he did, and I kept in some contact with him. I got a text. I knew they were pregnant with their second child. I got a text probably 7 or 8 months after they moved from here. Maybe it was a year. And he said, "Hey, I just want to let you know our daughter was born weekend." And he said, "We're going to baptize her Sunday." He said, "I'm getting baptized." I was in a meeting with Pastor Patterson at the time, and he saw me and he said, "What's the matter?" Because I was even more tearful than I am now. And I said, "Jay's getting baptized." That's the power of God's word. And there's an atheist inside all of us. Same cure, Jay. Cure for each of us, every single one of us. Get into God's word. Tap into, turn on the faucet. Let God come.